Hi everyone, and welcome to this week's edition of Trans Stupid, where I take a look at the wonderful world of LGBTQIA plus news because stupidity is intersectional. So I'm starting this week in the same way I've started every week for the last month, and that's documenting the titanic troon that is Jessica Yaniv. Now, Yaniv's had quite a busy week, as I'm sure a lot of you are aware, and this all started last Monday when Yaniv appeared on Blair White's channel in order to have a debate. And then this happened.
Blair,
you know what?
I don't need to be scared in my own house that I'm gonna get fucking attacked, which is illegal in Canada. Just saying. But
do you think that was like cute? Was that a moment for you?
So announcing to the world that you have an illegal weapon and then showing that said illegal weapon actually works is not the most intelligent move one can make. Now, I actually discussed this with Blair on a stream a couple of days later. A link to that will be in the description down below for those of you who haven't seen it. But as a result of this, a couple of minutes after the stream ended, in fact, Yaniv was arrested on account of having an illegal weapon. Yaniv's house was searched by police, but Yaniv was then released. So it's not entirely clear exactly what is happening now, but just to dispel any rumours that are going around, as far as I am aware, this is not in connection to child molestation or any kind of sexual activity. I've seen a couple of people comment on that. Unfortunately, we're not at that stage just yet, but I'm sure it's only a matter of time. Following the taser fallout, a reporter from The Rebel actually met up with Yaniv and Mama Yaniv to try and ask a couple of questions about whether Jessica has any illegal weapons lying around that aren't tasers. And then this happened.
Jessica, would I be able to ask you a few questions? Would you be able to... Do you have any...
Go away!
Do you have any...
Go away!
Do you have any weapons on you?
Go away!
Hey, don't touch me.
Don't touch me.
Get out.
Stay away from me.
This is private property.
Okay, you need to chill, lady. Do you have any weapons on you?
Get out.
I'm wondering,
I will show you in a minute. Unless you are the police, then you will be in court with me.
Yeah, I don't think so.
So yeah, it does appear that the Yaniv clan does have a couple of screws loose. So why am I bringing all of this up? I mean, by this point, it's probably quite old news, and you're right. Well, that's just to kind of build up the context for what I'm about to discuss, where we're seeing that not only do the Yanivs have weapons, but they are willing to get physical when they feel like it, really. So I'm not sure how many of you are aware of a website called Kiwi Farms. For those of you who aren't, it's essentially a site that covers some of the internet's biggest characters, documents a lot of their movements, effectively just makes fun of them. I personally quite enjoy the website. And it turns out that they have a whole area dedicated to Yaniv and, well, they're Yanivery, as it were. Now, when you're the subject of ridicule, approaching the mockers is something which is probably not the best move, as I'm sure Chris Chan could attest to. But Yaniv apparently wasn't put off by that, as they visited Kiwi Farms. Now, what did Yaniv get up to? Well, it's quite scary. In their first post, Yaniv tags a Kiwi Farms user, WG Kitty, and says, "You are going to fucking die. I know who you are, and I'm going to come there, slit your throat, and throw your body under the Golden Ears Bridge. Bob Adams knows who you are too, so you better stop. You going to die, motherfucker. Gonna die. You better not step out of the building, or else... Meow, 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 meow." Follow-up posts include, "Maybe putting a lien on that unit will scare WG Kitty off. I have connection, bitch. I like to play with pussies. I'm so drunk, holy shit. I like tight vaginas. There's so much cream on my pussy. Anyone want to lick it up? I just peed on my pad. Does anyone have a tampon? My pussy is bleeding. Tell us your first period story. Suck my ass." And Yaniv also decided to post some porn, which I'm not going to show here for obvious reasons. Now, Yaniv didn't actually return to Kiwi Farms, however the users did take a look into the profile, and they're pretty confident that this is indeed Jessica Yaniv. Now, this certainly is some high-level craziness, But at the same time, I think this is something that should be taken seriously. Death threats are not a laughing matter, regardless of who it comes from. And from what I'm aware of, WG Kitty is indeed someone who lives nearby to Yaniv. And this appears to be very targeted at them because Yaniv knows that they are nearby as well. Now, we've seen that the Yanivs have weapons, we've seen that they can get handsy on people, and we know that Yaniv is quite a loose cannon. I would personally take this seriously, and I think that things like this is what a lot of people should be focusing on more than some of the things that Yaniv does for obvious attention. An example of this is a tweet which they sent out about going to a pool, only to then say that they couldn't go swimming because they're on their period. Because Yaniv is apparently intersex, despite not knowing what intersex actually is. We get too wrapped up in the craziness and the fact that Yaniv is a caricature, someone who is very easy to mock, and believe me, I do have a good time laughing at their antics. But beneath all of that, there is indeed a worrying side, and it's something which we all need to be aware of, and it's the reason why I cover this character. If Yaniv was just an eccentric character, they might have been featured once or twice, and I would probably leave it at that. But as I've discussed in previous videos, there's a real dark side here. We've seen the messages that they've sent out, we've now seen the threats, we've seen the weapons. There's something really, really wrong with this person, but we need to make sure that whilst it's certainly obvious that Yaniv is enjoying this attention, we need to make sure that it's focused on the right things. Not so much the lunacy and the bizarre claims that they have periods, but the fact that it does appear far more likely than not, because I have to say allegedly, even though we all know the answer here, the messages, the threats, all of this is dangerous. Now, a lot of Kiwi Farms members did actually post support for WG Kitty, saying that they would protect them. And I think that that's a great sign that they are going to be looking out for this person who is clearly at risk here. Now, while Yaniv actually went quiet for a couple of days following those messages, on Monday, Yaniv actually put something out, not on Kiwi Farms, but they asked someone on Twitter to share this recording.
Hey there, this is Jessica Yaniv, and this is a message for WG Kitty. Listen, you need to stop. I'm just going to make it really frank. You are harassing me. I have done nothing to you. And this is now becoming criminal harassment. Also, because you're a tenant slash owner in this building, the building now gets involved. I have already advised Strata Council. I have advised Bob Adams as well. There will be legal action taken against this building due to your behavior. Now, this is what may happen. This is why I suggest you stop and delete all your posts. Reason being, what can happen is they can do a court-ordered sale of your building because of your behavior. I'm not instigating anything yet. Now, I want you to think that for a second. This whole building is going to be sued, and because of your behavior.
So it turns out Yaniv is really unhappy that this person continues to post, and despite Yaniv's own alleged death threats, it turns out WG Kitty is still the one in the wrong and needs to have all of their stuff removed from Kiwi Farms because it hurts Yaniv's feelings. And again, throwing their weight around, trying to threaten legal action to get their own way. This could all well be big words, but it's still quite troubling to have someone who is not happy because of some comments someone said about them, but then issued death threats, allegedly, and then still think, well, that person's still in the wrong, so I'm going to go ahead with legal action. But then this is Yaniv we're talking about. As to where Yaniv is going to go at this point, I keep thinking that every week that this is going to be the last we hear for a while, and then more craziness starts. I still think the real big update for Yaniv will be when we actually hear the results of the human rights complaints that they've raised, but that's not going to be for another couple of months. I'm sure they're going to try and stay in the spotlight as often as they can, but unless Yaniv is arrested on what we all highly suspect that they'll be arrested for, I don't know how much lower that they can really go here. But moving on from Yaniv, there is another topic that I do want to discuss, and this concerns a tweet that was sent out on the 7th of August by a Twitter user named Adrian Cahir. Now, what this person said was, achievement unlocked. I freaked out my first cis woman at Booz Allen Hamilton by existing in the bathroom. She came in, saw me, and then immediately left. Fuck you too. Now, unsurprisingly, this tweet got a lot of attention, and both good and bad. There were members of the trans community, for example, Rachel McKinnon, who voiced support for Adrian, who is also an Antifa activist and quite a loony one at that. But there was also a lot of criticism aimed at them, and as a result, they locked their Twitter account. So why am I bringing this up? I mean, this is just a random loon on the internet. Well, it's the fact that there were people who actually thought that this was a good thing to send. I remember years ago when trans women were first transitioning, and one of the things we would always be told is, like, try not to be awkward, try not to get people to look and stare at you, and if they are staring at you, you're doing something wrong. You need to figure out the way of correcting yourself. Well, this kind of tough love, in a way, seems to be disappearing more and more. It looks like we shouldn't be taking responsibility for ourselves anymore, and if or somebody else has the problem, well, fuck them, apparently.
We are not the freaks of society, everyone else is! Yeah!
This kind of approach is completely unreasonable. If you are a trans woman and you are getting people outright fleeing from you, you really are going wrong somewhere. I've been using female bathrooms for a very, very long time now, and I've not come anywhere near an experience like this. I can only put it up to this person probably being quite intimidating in person. And I don't think that a lot of trans women are going to be like this, but don't follow that kind of example. Don't put all the fault here onto the women who are going into women's bathrooms and then seeing someone it, let's be honest, doesn't necessarily even look much like a woman. I don't want this to kind of be like saying, I'm hotter than you. There's no effort to pass here. So you're going to get stares. And when you get stares, you're also probably going to be making a few people feel a bit awkward, a bit nervous. And the community really needs to get over this whole idea that everybody else is in the wrong. Take responsibility for your transition. It's the only way it's going to be of any real success. Now, the final story that I want to touch on today involves a company that I kind of have a bit of respect for. So GI Collection, for those who don't know, is a lingerie brand aimed at pre-op trans women. Personally, I think that that's actually quite a good idea. There's going to, I mean, because you have a little bit extra down there, let's be honest. Having something that can kind of help with that and help deal with that dysphoria is certainly a good idea. And, well, the free market clearly enjoys it because it sold out when it was first released. So there is a little bit of respect that I have for the brand. So why are they in trans stupid then? I mean, this is a show where I kind of critique stuff. Well, let's see what their next move is. GI Collection launches underwear lineup for trans kids. Yay! A transgender women's lingerie brand claims to have launched a world's first underwear range that has been designed especially for transgender children. GI Collection, a transgender clothing, beauty and fashion brand, say it stands proud at the forefront of innovation with its latest announcement. Its boundary-breaking underwear range, designed by founder Carmen Liu, wants to make it clear that transgender people of all ages deserve to be treated the same as everyone else. The Carmen Liu Kids range of undergarments will target the trans population and aims to allow trans children to feel like they belong within their own body at a young age. Set to launch one underwear range for trans girls, the Carmen Liu Kids brand will feature patented technology which it says is designed especially for the unique needs of trans girls and their bodies. And Carmen promises it will fuel a shift in the way transgender people grow up, tackling identity issues from a young age. And this is apparently at a stark contrast to the limited choice of products currently on the market, which can prevent transgender women feeling like the women they are. Carmen also said, everyone should be offered the same basic right of unrestricted clothing. and transgender children are no exception. Now, we don't exactly know what this lingerie brand for kids is going to look like. I'm sure that they're not going to be going with anything particularly inappropriate, but I can't be the only one that still finds this a little bit weird, and this kind of tucks onto the whole way in which we're seeing a weird increase in the amount of young people who are transitioning. And I mean, this isn't really the weirdest thing that we've seen in regards to focusing on little kids' genitals. I mean, there was a woman a couple of years ago who sold packers for trans boys as young as 5, and that is a little penis thing they can put in their underwear, which is really, really weird. I find the whole focus on this kind of thing weird. A kid shouldn't really be thinking much about their genitals one way or another at that age. When they get to becoming a teenager, going on adult, then certainly I can see a bit more of an argument there. But when it comes to trans kids, this seems a lot like a virtue signal more than anything. Just a point of saying, well, look, we accept the trans kids, and I'm sure that the likes of mermaids are going to champion this as well. They'll be saying this is the best thing ever. Like, whilst my whole attitudes towards trans kids is still something which I'm ultimately developing, I don't see how anything like this would have really affected me at a young age. But once again, we're seeing so much of a focus on young children transitioning. I think that this is something which is still quite controversial, and I'm not completely comfortable with this kind of thing being marketed to kids. Maybe allow them to grow up a little bit before giving them this kind of underwear. Let's be honest, I don't think this is a particularly good move. But we know what the trans community is like. I'm sure it will get lots and lots of celebrations until someone feels as though they're left out by it. But what are your thoughts on the stories I've covered this week? Is there anything in particular I've missed out? Please let me know in the comments. Thank you all so much for watching. Please be sure to like, subscribe, and you can also support me on Patreon and Subscribestar if you like what I do. There's also a link to my Discord down below. Thank you all again. I'll see you all next time. And a special thank you to James UK, Sarah, Evil Moif, Gotta Get Me, James, Prue, The Poor of Rizzo, and the rest of my supporters on Patreon and Subscribestar.